I'm Jennifer Rabb and have the great privilege of being the president of this extraordinary institution, Hunter College. And it is particularly heartwarming tonight to welcome you to Roosevelt House, to our Public Policy Institute, for the 5th annual Joan H. Tisch Public Health Forum. And it is so appropriate that we are here at Roosevelt House, the home of two of the great visionaries of people who cared so much about social justice and a thought of the future of a better world, to have the forum named for another extraordinary New York family, and that, of course, is the Tisch family. What the Tisch family have done here in honor of their mom, Joan, and that's Lori, who's here with us tonight, Jonathan and Stephen, is to help create a really, truly transformational program at Hunter College in which we are truly educating the future of our city and of our country in the importance of the impacts of public health. And tonight, Lori, as you represent the family here, I hope you really feel just the energy, the commitment of what this wonderful gift has done for Hunter College and by way then to New York City, because this is truly an engaged community. We have students here, we have faculty here, we have friends and supporters from the neighborhood and visitors from around the country who are on the cutting lines of public health. And that is, of course, something that you yourself are so engaged in now with your leadership, with food carts, with your leadership in films promoting the importance of public health as a real access and social justice issue. And just 5 years ago, we approached you and your family when you said you wanted to do something in honor of your mother, who, as so many of us know, was a true hands-on philanthropist. Yes, she supported through financial means so many of the on-the-ground charities that she was involved in, but it was much more. This is somebody who went to organizations and helped, you know, open the mail and carry around the trays and truly threw herself into the needs of New Yorkers. And by honoring her, by investing in our students and in our faculty and in the creation of new knowledge and new ways of viewing public health, you truly carry on her extraordinary legacy. Tonight we have the Tisch Forum, which is one part of this wonderful program supported by the Tisch family in honor of Joan. We'll soon hear from a renowned scholar and physician, Richard Jackson. But Richard tonight joins truly an illustrious group of American scholars and international scholars who have been Tisch Fellows and who have been part of these extraordinary Tisch Forums. And there's a wide range of intellects who have really infused the faculty and our students and our community with new ideas. We started with an extraordinary leader, John McDonough, who is spends his time now at that other H school up in Cambridge. But we were lucky through the Tisch program to have John McDonough here as he left Senator Kennedy's staff, having put together the pieces of, you know, truly notable healthcare reform. And John made really such a difference in the lives of students here by inspiring them to think about careers both in government and academia, and in truly explaining to people some of the really important parts of the act, which focus on preventing disease, which is one of the themes of our School of Public Health. So it seems suitable now to, as we celebrate John McDonough as our first Tisch Fellow, is to recognize the wonderful Ted Kennedy Jr., who's in the audience and now representing really the spirit of your dad, who did so much for this incredible issue. So Ted, you should just stand so we can recognize you. And John McDonough was followed by Georges Benjamin, who is the executive director of the American Public Health Association. And then last year by a really interesting figure, Sue Atkinson, who was a leader of food policy in England. And we spent a lot of time talking about our comparative focus on these two, on this area. So we've created new knowledge, we've inspired our students. And then through this generous program, we've created a Tisch Prize. And the prize recognizes those who are not too often and not often enough recognized for their work. and in your mother's memory, the people who toil on the ground in the community. And those people have, in addition to being recognized, have become part of our community, the community of our students and our scholars in public health, continuing to infuse us and our learning about better ways to improve access and a more just society. So I want to recognize Rubina Niaz from Turning Point for Women, who does so much for supporting domestic violence. And Mark Hanay, who's one of the leaders in access to healthcare. And I think this is by building, not just recognizing the work of Rubina and of Mark and of their fellow Tisch Prize winners, but to have them come back and be part of our community as we really build a group of people who are on the front line of improving access to care and improving thinking about public health is what this program is all about, and really talks to the incredible impact that the Joan Tisch Fellow Program has had at Hunter College. So, Lori, on behalf of all of us at Hunter College, and we say to you and to your brothers, thank you for seriously transformative philanthropy, which is really will have its impact as our students, our scholars, and our prize winners go out and make a difference in this city. So we know you don't want to speak tonight, but we want you to stand up and be recognized for this really extraordinary gift. So it is now time to turn to our Renaissance man. And where is he hiding? Ah, there he is, okay. Richard, I asked for a bio of all the things that you've done. And in addition to the television show, which was highlighted, I got about 20 pages of wonderful things in so many different areas in which you've had an impact. And that impact has certainly been felt at Hunter College. Your energy and your vision, you are a health professional, a pediatrician, the chair of environmental health sciences at UCLA, the former chief health officer for the state of California, and a member of the U.S. Institute of Medicine of the National Academy of Sciences, and also the former director of CDC's National Center for Environmental Health. But mostly, you are somebody who really, I think, breathes and thinks and loves this question of who are we as a healthy society? And that is the message and the idea and the question that you have brought to our students this year as you've been in resident as the Tisch Fellow. You have inspired our faculty to think in different ways. You've inspired us to think across lines from the arts to healthcare, to our nursing school, to our education school, but how everybody has to be involved in this conversation about public health. And so in that way, you truly are a Renaissance thinker as much as a Renaissance man, and it has really been an extraordinary privilege for us to have you in our community this year, making such a difference in how we think and changing how we approach so many things. So tonight you've brought an extraordinary panel of experts with you. I will just thank all of you and let Richard more appropriately introduce you. But I'm so happy that you chose to make Hunter College your home. So grateful that the Tisch has made this possible. And I have to say, once you're a Tisch Fellow, always a Tisch Fellow. So we know that you will be back and you will be visiting and you will continue in the next years to be part of this incredibly important conversation. So please join me in thanking and welcoming Dr. Richard Jackson.
I'll have more to say about why I got into this public health business a little later on, but it had a lot to do with the picture behind me on the wall. I'm going to introduce two of our panelists, and then I will introduce our moderator before we go forward. Patrick Dougherty. Patrick is the Deputy Director of the National Security Studies Program at the New America Foundation. He's Director of the Smart Strategy Initiative and seeks to challenge the central challenges facing the U.S. and the nature of the function of New American Strategy. He's been very widely published, but I gave a talk at the New America Foundation about 2 years ago, and I was talking about built environment and health, and this fellow comes up and goes, "We're working with the Pentagon." I said, "Oh, wow." Yeah, this is really cool. Well, next thing I know, this report comes out in the January issue of Foreign Policy, a new U.S. grand strategy, and it's a spectacular piece. Why walkable communities, sustainable economics, and multilateral diplomacy are the future of American power. So this is really interesting. And then he introduced me to Colonel Mark Mickleby, Puck Mickleby, who, if you can't tell, is a Marine Corps pilot. Take one look at him, and you will realize that he was commissioned as a second lieutenant in the Marine Corps following graduation from the U.S. Naval Academy in 1987, and from 1991 to 2006, served in 5 fleet fighter squadrons. His operational experience included numerous deployments in Europe, Pacific, and Southwest Asian theaters. In June 2007, Mark was assigned to the U.S. Special Operations Command, where he developed a strategy for the Special Operations Forces. He actually served in the Pentagon as they thought about a sustainability strategy for the United States. And finally, we have our moderator, Michelle Wooker, and Michelle is very widely published. I'll only mention a couple of her books, but she's president of the World Policy Institute, publisher of the World Policy Journal, and the author of Lockout: Why America Keeps Getting Immigration Wrong When Our Prosperity Depends on Getting It Right, in 2006. And in 1999, Why the Cox Fight: Dominicans, Haitians, and the Struggle for Hispaniola. She's received numerous awards and has been very, very broadly published. But I think at this point, Michelle, we'll ask you to be our moderator, and I'll ask our speakers to come on up and join us for this dialogue. And thank you all very much for being here. Which one's the Marine Corps colonel?
Great. Rick, thanks for that wonderful and humorous introduction, which is a great way to kick off the evening. I don't want to let you let go of your responsibilities quite yet. In kicking things off, since this is the forum on health, I thought you'd be able to kick us off with a little bit of framing of why we're here talking about health and grand strategy in the same sentence, and how those fit together.
My dad had been a fighter pilot during World War II. He crashed at Iwo Jima once, came through it, came back home in 1946, married, had 3 little babies over a relatively short time. And in 1949, he could do 100 push-ups at a time. And within 2 days, he developed polio in August 1949. And died of that disease, leaving my mother with 3 tiny children. And I think that experience probably led me to pediatrics. It certainly led me to public health and infectious disease control. And led me to really understanding how growing up in poverty can be very difficult for people. After my dad died, my grandmother, his mom, decided she would do something with her life. She'd never worked a real job, outside job, in her life. She went over and learned to be a secretary, and she went to work for, you guessed it, the March of Dimes. And she was convinced that she had to contribute to the end of polio. She became friends with Daniel Bergsma, Dr. Clark, all the heads of, and I grew up hearing stories of Franklin Roosevelt and what a major contribution he and Eleanor had made to the well-being of America. And so when I received a call asking me if I wanted to live in Franklin Roosevelt's house and contribute to thinking about public health, about pediatrics, and the future of the planet, it was such an amazing gift. And Lori, Tisch, and President Rabb, I really want to thank you for allowing me to be here for the last few months. I've learned so much. Franklin Roosevelt was confronted with enormously destabilizing forces, as we all know, the Great Depression and the boom-bust of the economic system. He thought a lot about what were the economic brakes that we needed to put in the system to control that. And he also confronted immense totalitarian threats, Nazism and imperialism on both sides. And he needed to figure out a course that worked at home for the country and also internationally at the same time to maintain the viability of this country, because the old thinking before 1930 wasn't going to work any longer. So I'm a pediatrician, and in pediatrics, when you go see the pediatrician, the first thing they do is plot out the heights and weight. And you want that child to be tracking at whatever percentile they are. If they're 70th percentile, you want them 70th percentile for weight, and you don't want them to fall off the growth curve. You want them, and in peds, we actually think of a child, a visit with a child as a snap, a one frame in a movie, not a snapshot, because you're really trying to see the progression of that child's life. Andy Ackerman knows this well from his work at the Children's Museum, endowed by Laurie as well. So I'm really worried with what's happening with the children in America. The average child in America now, 15-year-olds, about 15 pounds heavier than they were two generations ago. Most American kids cannot walk and do not walk or bike to school, 90% of them, compared to about 90% don't walk, compared to about 80% did walk just a generation ago. Average American adults, 27 pounds heavier, and two out of every volunteers for the United States military cannot get in because of lack of fitness and obesity. This is not just a health threat. And clearly being that obese raises our risk of developing diabetes. When I was a young pediatrician, I never saw a child with type 2 diabetes. We called it adult onset diabetes. And back then, we were only spending 7% of all the money in the United States on medical care. Today, we're spending close to 19% of all the money in the United States on medical care. And if you walk into the pediatric diabetes clinic, half the kids have adult onset diabetes. And they're extremely difficult to manage. Now we call it type 2 diabetes. And the meds are difficult to manage. It's really a problem. We're seeing children now with fatty livers that look like pre-cirrhosis of the liver related to the diets and the activity levels of our children. So for a lot of reasons, even though we're spending 19% of all of our money on medical care, the trajectory for where we are going is extraordinarily worrisome. And we're also facing a constellation of threats to these costs. And most Americans are unhappy with our medical care system, and they're certainly unhappy with their insurance programs, particularly when they're trying to make claims. And yet we're spending 18-19% of the GDP, and we rank number 46 in life expectancy in the world. We're doing something wrong. And the 60% of the people facing bankruptcy in the United States now face it because of medical costs. And as an environmental health person, and I did this for 9 years, I worried about little stuff and big stuff for a long time, atoms of lead in our bodies and brains, global climate change. When I was born, the planet had 2 billion people, and the CO2 level of planet Earth, the atmosphere, was 300 parts per million. Today, it is 400 parts per million. And the more greenhouse gases we put in the atmosphere, the more energy is in the atmosphere, the more heat, the more moisture, and climate change is real. In fact, in California, I'm always impressed that we're doing a lot in terms of prevention of greenhouse gas releases into the atmosphere. When I got to New York, I realized New York had thought a whole lot more than we did about how you are resilient in the face of sea level rise and massive storms. I have to tell you, as I read the Filipino representative to the meeting in Warsaw on climate, it almost brought me to tears as the man described, when are we going to stop what we are doing? And he described the destruction in his country from this enormous storm. The past scales for measuring the power of a storm, 1 through 5. We never really, you know, Sandy was only a 3. And New Orleans was close to a 4. That storm in the Philippines, they didn't have a scale number for it. They made it up as a 6 with 230 mile an hour winds. This is the product of more energy in the atmosphere. This is not a political statement. It is what we are doing, particularly to low-lying countries, to countries like Bangladesh, the island countries where the sea level comes in, it destroys the rice fields, it destroys the underground water, freshwater aquifers, and we could easily be facing 150 million refugees. This is destabilizing in ways that the most serious generals aren't talking politics, they're talking about what is going to happen as we face these changes going into the future. So I believe we are at a moment of real crisis for this country. And crisis is often a good thing because it gets the country to think and begin moving, but it's not something to be ignored.
Great. Thanks for kicking us off with such a beautiful personal story of why this is so important to you. And wanted to thank the Tisch family and Hunter College and Roosevelt House for giving us the opportunity to talk about some of these issues. I've been spending a lot of time lately thinking about some of the highly probable, the obvious high-impact crises that we're facing. We all know, you know, we hear climate change and kind of eyes glaze over. You had a problem with education, problems with poverty, problems with health, although not quite in the detail that we've heard tonight. And we all tend to think, this is so big, this is so overwhelming, what can I do about it? Or you leave it to the leaders of the country, leave it to somebody else who's an expert, who knows how to deal with this problem. And because of that, even though you might think that we'd be very good at facing up to crises that are highly obvious, that are highly probable, that we know are going to get us, paradoxically, we're absolutely terrible at standing up to them and doing something so that we don't get trampled. And so the conversation tonight is so appropriate, and health is such a great lens, particularly with all the headlines we've been seeing in the news lately. I think it's also very appropriate that we're talking about it in terms of grand strategy, and particularly under this amazing picture of FDR, who was really one of the masters of looking at things in the big picture, you know, facing lots and lots of different highly probable, not even highly probable, threats that had already happened, that we were already in the middle of, and had to deal with a lot of questions about how do you prioritize, how do you get all of these things to be fixed, particularly when you can't untangle one from the other. So tonight, we're really struggling with two seemingly polar opposite challenges. One, unless you focus in on something very specific, unless you can really know what you're grasping, it's hard to get the momentum and the urge and the drive to change something. But on the other hand, if you're not looking at the big picture, you can put all your effort into one thing, and something that's related but not your central focus can come in and bowl you out of the water and undo all of the efforts that you've made in that one direction. So that's the framework that this conversation is taking place in tonight, and I'm absolutely delighted to be here with people from three very, very different backgrounds, you know, from health, from the military, and from the big picture policy angle. So with that, I wanted to move on to some of our other perspectives. Puck, perhaps you could talk to us a little bit more about we've had the health perspective. Now, maybe from the security, from the military perspective, what do you see as what's facing us? What are the challenges that we need to think of when we're formulating a grand strategy?
Right. Well, thanks for having me here, Patrick, as well. We've been amigos trying to get through this big list since about 2010 together. So it's great work. It's challenging work. But to get to your question, the first thing. I'm going to tell probably just a quick story about being asked to go to the Pentagon to work on a thing called Grand Strategy by Admiral Mullen. But the first thing I want to just maybe get our brains around the idea that stop talking about national security as if it's a military thing. We've got a vastly, vastly complex array of issues that we have to approach in a vastly, vastly different design model. And that goes to public health, it goes to food, it goes to water, it goes to energy, it goes to just our political discourse. And not only in this country, but on a global scene. So security has got to be far more broadly defined than what we currently look at it. And to Dick's point, you know, if you take any look at any trend line in the United States today, we're not trending in a positive direction. I don't care if you're talking about our education, our economy, our political system, our public health. We're not trending in a positive direction. And I think that was the sense that Admiral Mullen had in 2009 when I got pulled from Special Operations Command, doing strategy there, to work alongside a guy that said he's a longtime made man on the Mullen family, a Navy captain named Wayne Porter, really a brilliant guy. He'd been on Admiral Mullen's personal staff for about 7 years. Well, Wayne and I were sat down in front of Admiral Mullen, and he said, "All right, gentlemen, I want you to go figure out a grand strategy for the country." That's what I said, too. And, but, you know, Wayne and I were There's a bunch of other story behind it, but we don't have time to go into it, but it really was a comedy of comedies. But we got out of Admiral Mullen's office. This was about July of 09, and we went down to our little office, and we looked at each other and said, how the hell are we going to go do this? But the first thing we decided was we weren't going to write another strategy, because that was the last thing that America needs right now, is another strategy coming out of Washington, D.C., with the punched-up policy language that nobody really gave a damn about. You know, and yeah, somebody would read the executive summary, put it on their coffee table, and go, yeah, I read that one. What's next? We didn't want to do that. What we wanted to do was start a new conversation about grant strategy in a more efficacious form, and in a form that would resonate with American citizenry. Now, my calculus in doing what we did were the sensibilities of Mom and Dad Mickleby in Wayzata, Minnesota, because that's where I come from. You know, they're just good old-fashioned, lower middle class, fiscally conservative, socially moderate people that are just slugging it out in life. And by the way, they made sure that they committed their life to making sure their kids' life was better. And I thought, that'd be somebody I'd want to talk to, because I really didn't want to talk to anybody in Washington. So, no offense if you're from Washington, but you get my drift. And so, when Wayne and I looked at each other, we said, you know, that's what we're going to do. What America really needs right now is a story. It doesn't need a strategy, it needs a narrative. And what we ended up writing, and I don't know if Admiral Mullen wanted this, but this is what he got from us, was a national strategic narrative, a document about 12 pages long. We wrote it. I got there in July of 09, and we wrote it by August of 09. And basically all we looked at, we just said, what is our current, I mean, this is Lincoln 101 strategy stuff. He said, if you know where you are and whither you're tending, you can better judge what to do and how to do it. Well, that's where we started. We just put a mirror in front of our face and just said, okay, what's America about today? And what we found out was that, you know what? America, we've become a force of the status quo. We are still beholden to legacy systems of containment. That was a strategy that was desperately needed at the time in our history. But guess what? In 1991, when the Soviet Union went away, what did we do? We didn't do anything. We just kept the system on life support that was designed to leverage force and power so you could have a measure of control in the world. And what Wayne and I said was that, well, you know what? The world really isn't a closed system that you can control. It's actually really an open system, and it actually adheres more to the rules of an ecology than it does to, you know, the game of Stratego. And that was an epiphany for Wayne and I. We said, you know what? It's really more of a strategic ecology where we do have interdependencies, and where our best America can be is when we're the best competitor, yes, but also the best contributor to this strategic ecology. And when you started thinking in ecological terms, you got away from force and power and control, and you had to start thinking in different terms, in terms of what is my, as an organism in an ecology, what's my strength? How do I become the strongest organism? But also, how do I have credibility and influence in the world? And I'm talking about influence the noun, not influence the verb. By walking the talk, I mean, I've been a Scandinavian bumpkin from Minnesota, you know, it's like mandatory reading. You got to read Beowulf, you know? Yeah. I'm Norwegian by trade, but you know they were Danes, but it's close enough. But I mean, there's this great line in Beowulf. It says that the path to power, behavior that's admired is the path to power among people everywhere. Behavior that's admired, it's walking the talk. And we are still talking about the old last great season. You know, we're like at our 20th high school reunion talking about all the great stuff we did in the past. Well, nobody cares. You know, I made this point. I was in a debate with somebody that was a neocon icon not too long ago at the Naval Academy. And we were still talking in terms of the Cold War and containment and those constructs. And I said, raise your hand. There were a bunch of midshipmen, a bunch of other college students. I said, raise your hand if you were alive when there was a Soviet Union. You know how many hands went up in the air? One. And that guy, God bless him, was a former enlisted Marine who made it in the Naval Academy. And so he was just older and crustier than the rest of the crew. One hand. But yet that's why we're defining the future of these kids. And that's a mistake. So Wayne and I said, we aren't going to contribute to that. So what would be that idea in a strategic ecology? What would be the coalescing idea, just like containment was when in the Cold War, that could galvanize foreign and domestic policy to take on this, whatever this new challenge is? And Wayne and I, one word kept coming up, and was the word sustainability. The ecological definition of sustainability, that an organism's ability to remain diverse and productive over time. And why did we say that? Because it maps to our current condition. The interdependencies, the open system nature of where we live, but most importantly, for the American perspective, it maps directly to our enduring national interests of prosperity and security. That definition, diverse and productive over time, diversity means depth, means redundancy, means resilience. It means our national capacity to take a gut punch and come back swinging. And right now, we have got the antithesis of resilience, if you look at our financial system, our economic system, our education system, our physical health system. We're absolutely the opposite. And the other part, though, in terms of an organism's ability to remain productive, we're talking about growth. But we fundamentally have to come to terms with the fact that we live in a resource-constrained environment. You know, and yet we're like we're a mosquito that just hit a vein, and we don't know we need to pull the stinger out. I mean, we're getting bloated here. You know, 1/3 of our nation's clinically obese. 50% of Iowa's topsoil's gone. The Ogallala Aquifer is already drying up. In 15 years, you may not be able to tap enough water to grow food. These are the basic issues that the Sumerians and the Romans faced, and they didn't have the guts to take them on. Are we really going to follow their path? Because that's what the trajectory we're on right now. And just to let you know, it's not all gloom and doom. There's an opportunity's way out, because we are, and this is what we're going to get to here in a second, we have an opportunity-based way out. We're the land of opportunity. We're not the land of threat and risk. We can frame out our new national design to take on this great global challenge, which truly is global unsustainability, and be a leader in that realm. That's what we wrote in the narrative. And we said that if we could fundamentally converge foreign and domestic policy around that idea, and we use a low-hanging fruit of you know, the language of the time in 2009 was smart growth at home can become our smart power abroad. Because when we take on our challenges, these vexing systemic problems of food, water, energy, built environment, social equity. Yeah, I said it, I'm a Marine. I said social equity. Hope you can deal with that one. But if we can figure out that here at home, now we are going to be walking that talk. We will truly have that behavior that's admired that will give us the credibility and influence to course a new path in the world going forward. But it starts here at home. That's not isolationism. It's just stoic philosophy on steroids. If Epictetus was here, he'd say, why are you squirreling around trying to control the uncontrollable? You know? You need to control what you can control. You know, that's Stoic Philosophy 101. All right? And that's what's in our capacity, what's within our reach, and most importantly, it's a language and it's a trajectory that we can engage American citizenry to take on their own future and take stock of their own condition and, more importantly, forge a new path forward for their kids and their grandkids. Because that truly is the visceral connection that those founding fathers said in the preamble of the Constitution, which truly defines our perennial purpose. And not only the perennial purpose of this country, but also our obligation as citizens to this country, particularly that part to secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity. That's what grand strategy is about, and not just wonky stuff in D.C. So that's why we wrote the narrative. And that was also the opportunity to meet this guy at New America Foundation in 2010. And under the horizon, because I was still in uniform, we formed this little cabal to take that idea of the narrative, sustainability is a grand strategic imperative, and figure out what's the so what of that. Let's get on with the so what of that. So over to Patrick.
Great. Thanks, Puck. I think it was really great that you draw the connection between not just strategy and thinking deep thoughts, but really turning it into walking the talk, making it action, and making it very much happen. And I also love that you've emphasized the importance of the story in all of this, because the story is really what connects policy and strategy to each one of us. And I think it's why health is so important in this narrative, because everyone has health issues, and you know, everyone's, you know, parents, everyone's kids. And so I think it's a wonderful way to get people to think differently about where we're going and how we get there. So with that, Patrick, I'm going to leave you with the easy question of what does all this mean for grand strategy? First of all, you know, what is grand strategy? Where does health fit into it? And how do we turn grand strategy into real life change?
Sure. Thank you, Michelle, and thanks to Dick for putting this on and inviting us up here, and to President Rabb and Ms. Tisch for making this all possible. Grand strategy is fundamentally the correlation of a nation's economic engine, its governing institutions, and its foreign policy to meet the great global challenge of the era. In a vision of American history in the long durée, I think you would also define it this way, is that it's the approach by which any generation creates the conditions, both domestically and globally, that allow Americans to live out the preamble to the Constitution. And that we have an exquisitely crafted Constitution that allows every generation to do that. We are principle heavy in that Constitution and institution light. The founders knew that after the tyranny of George I, and avoiding that, getting rid of that, avoiding the tyranny of a George Washington, of a tyrannical presidency, the next thing they wanted to structure the Constitution to avoid was the tyranny of institutions. And they did that by creating a constitution that was heavy on principle and light on those institutions so that every generation can take care of it. So grand strategy in the modern era was really shaped by FDR. And what he and his team were able to put together to confront World War II is really the legacy that we're, and the foundation that we're building on today and with this program, with PUC. When FDR was confronted with fascism, he was confronted with fascism at a time of great economic hardship. We still hadn't really come out of the second dip of the Great Depression. We had a military force of about 450,000 men under arms, and we had two continental scale empires really destroying our lines of communication and closing in on democracies in the West. He understood that to address this great global challenge required a whole of society effort. But what he also understood further was that the secret to American success in grand strategy would not be our force of arms, but fundamentally the strength of our economy. And so if you want to sum up why we won the World War II, it was this phrase that FDR coined and used in the context of a fireside chat. We became the arsenal of democracy. And so this last definition of grand strategy I want to leave you with is that the way that America does grand strategy is that we stand on that economic engine. We let it do the strategic heavy lifting of the era. And then we close the gap with our foreign policy. And we craft institutions of government to allow us to execute and thrive under that economic engine and pursue our foreign policy objectives, while at the same time keeping in mind, I think, a great charge that Puck is fond of quoting that also came from our founding era, from Thomas Paine, that really the purpose of America is in large measure the purpose of all mankind. That if we keep our eye on that goal, to solve not only America's challenge, but to solve the great global challenge, identify the great global project, then and only then can America be successful. And so that's, for the definition, that's where we've come out. It sounds huge and enormous. What we had to do in the project was to make it understandable and make it modern. And so what we've said, we've adopted some modern strategic planning methodologies. Particular one developed it up at that other H school, and created a simple framework for understanding this. That grand strategy is simply the correlation of our economic engine, our governing institutions, our foreign policy to address the great challenge of the era. The trick, though, with grand strategy is really understanding what Puck and Dick were talking about. What is that great global challenge that confronts the United States? How do we articulate that and understand that as a challenge, as a singular challenge facing the country? And how do we mobilize the American people so that they can understand that their best chance at prosperity, security, and in this era, sustainability, will be met by working together to address that shared challenge? And so that's where we came down with the definition of grand strategy.
And so where's the role of health in that? And actually, before you answer, I just wanted to give like a heads up. After this, what I want to do after this is to go through to each of you and do sort of a rapid fire, you know, what are the top three things that need to be fixed? What's sure. broken? So sure. with that, and then you guys can start thinking.
So let me quickly articulate what we think those four great challenges are, because it lays the foundation for how we get to public health. We think there are four great challenges that are now converging in time and space and are now fundamentally coupled. And creating a system, an international order, and a domestic order that is fundamentally unsustainable. The first is rapid economic inclusion. If you had to define the Great Global Project right now as one thing, it is rapid economic inclusion. We are in the process of bringing 3 billion people into the global middle class in 20 years. We have never done that as a planet before. That is taxing our resource and energy base, our natural capital in extraordinary ways. Commodity prices are at or near all-time highs, food prices as well. It is driving our strategic reality. And many regional conflicts that are local in nature are now starting to get pulled into the orbit of that challenge. Number two is ecosystem depletion, right? It's climate change plus the destruction of natural capital and ecosystem services. We know that story very well. Third is our domestic economic, macroeconomic condition. We call it a contained depression, taking the term from Martin Wolf of the Financial Times. We're in the midst of a massive economic deleveraging, not unlike what President Roosevelt addressed in his first term. It has been contained by extraordinary intervention on the part of the federal government, first by the Congress and the President, now solely by $1 trillion of stimulus spending on the part of the Federal Reserve each year. And then finally, a resilience deficit. Our systems, our supply chains, our infrastructure is fundamentally dysfunctional. It is brittle, prone to shock, disruption, and capture. And whether that is our public health infrastructure or our energy infrastructure, our supply chains, the system is extraordinarily fragile. And that those four problems, inclusion, depletion, contained depression, and resilience, are now fundamentally coupled. If you're the President of the United States, your inbox is filled with the symptoms of those four challenges. And right now, our republic can't even talk about those symptoms we're talking. We're manufacturing our own crises to deal with in Washington. We can't even get to the symptoms, much less address the problems. If you wanted to solve for the root causes, you now have to solve for the set. If you want to solve for climate change, you have to do it in the midst of a contained depression at home with extraordinary wage and price competition globally. And with all your infrastructure facing in the exact opposite direction. Start any one place, you've got a problem. And so to bring this back to public health, what we're seeing as the old idea that public policy should address the great challenges of the day with symptom issue solution pairs. Here's a problem, here's the fix. Doesn't work. We're entering an era of systemic dysfunction. And it is only by reestablishing a new fundamental system, and we argue that it is that system that was designed to defeat the Soviet Union, grand strategy of containment that had both domestic economic components as well as foreign policy components, that fundamental infrastructure of policy is out of date. And it is only by reimagining that economic engine and having a new economic engine for the country do our strategic heavy lifting that we're going to get there. But fundamentally, that when we talk about what that economic engine is, we look back to the early days of the Cold War and we get to the fundamental basis of that economy was the new American dream, suburbia. When we look at economic engineering, the way that FDR and Truman and Eisenhower understood it, they understood it as a simple formula of demand plus capital minus stranded assets. The demand that they tapped into after World War II was secular instead of manufactured demand of war production for World War II. And that demand was fundamentally for housing, for cheap consumer goods after 16 years of austerity from Great Depression and war, and for reconstruction materials for Europe and Japan, the Marshall Plan. That fundamentally was the demand that we tapped into and we shaped to outperform and outlast the Soviet Union. And it's that economic engine that is still alive today and creating great strategic dysfunction. And it's at the heart of how we design our communities. It's at the heart of how we feed our people. The rationale that informs all these systems that are driving bad health in the United States, these two, what we talk about as the two fundamental upstream drivers of bad health, where we live and what we eat, those are hardwired into the old economic engine. And we believe that to make a change at that level of the system, you need a full system rationale. You need a full grant strategy.
Great, and so I want to take the next few questions and answers super quickly because I do want to open it up to the audience quickly because that's always the most fun part of these things, I think, for everyone. So top three, what's broke, what do we need to do?
One is, after World War II, we became obsessed with labor-saving devices. And we, to buy a carton of milk, people got in the car. We developed instruments to do, you know, we built buildings where it was impossible to find a stairway. And in every way, we removed people's ability to walk, to exercise. And we thought we were doing people a favor, and it turns out the worst thing you could do. If you're an unfit 45-year-old male and you become fit, you add about 8 years to your life. And so putting human physical activity back into it, it's a bargain in terms of carbon footprint. It's a bargain in terms of people's health. We're not importing stuff and putting our military in harm's way, trying to extract stuff from very dangerous places. So people using their bodies again. And by the way, the most prevalent disorder after tooth care, dental disease in the United States is depression. And for mild to moderate depression, the best therapy you can have is to be physically active, especially physically active in places with other people, in community, with people who care about us, and preferably in natural settings. Two, natural settings do a bunch of benefits, and 1/6 of all the climate change that we've seen is due to deforestation. And removing large amounts of forest land for, you know, making paper that we then throw away, whatever we're going to do, makes no sense. We've got to commit to that as well. I feel very strongly that, you know, 25% of all the economic engine of the United States in the 20th century was due to burning fossil fuels, particularly oil and cars, and using cars. And thinking about how we can tax, and you have this in your, we have to tax waste instead of wages. And if we taxed waste and we really disincentivized waste, and frankly, burning $200 million worth of methane in the Bakken out in North Dakota, you know, in the fracking wells, the enormous amounts of waste that we have put in place is just staggering. And that's what we should be taxing. And I was state epidemiologist for New York back in 1975, 76. Every town, every community I went to had a small business, had an economic engine. And I would argue the deindustrialization of the United States is as serious a public health threat as all of us getting overweight and getting out of shape, because being unemployed is not good for any of us. So really, I think this economic engine, big thing. First thing we teach medical students, Kiki knows this, is make the diagnosis. Because if you're treating 15 different symptoms in 15 different ways, you're making the person sicker, not better. You have to figure out what the underlying disorder is. And I think our underlying sickness is we've misused God's gifts on this planet in profound ways.
That's a great, great summary. I think it's fantastic. Pug?
Only get three, right?
You only get three, and three short ones, because I really didn't want to bring everybody in.
Okay, I'll just do the Reader's Digest version. Number one, the energy policy. If you want to have something that impacts now, you can really go bare-knuckled on America, energy policy, and here's why. This crap about energy independence. Well, there is no energy independence if you're still dependent on fossil fuels. So we just need to start talking about that, because there's a whole wave of energy going forward, not only in the United States, but in the world, that we could capitalize right now. We could be the leader in. And that is what that's the kind of bold, innovative approaches to the world that the rest of the world's waiting on America to do. Just ask the former Prime Minister of Australia, Julia Gillard, when she went to a joint session of Congress, in her closing comments was, be bold, live up to your best and finest traditions. You know, so what did we do? We ignored her, right? Energy policy is a place where we can demonstrate global boldness and put ourselves back in a position of leadership again from how we act and not just what we say. I had to get that off my chest because this energy independence crap is killing me, all right? The second thing is on the domestic policy front, we need to start creating a new language. We need to create a new language in the built form. I'm talking about, you know, smart growth, walkable communities, that stuff. But, I mean, right now Americans don't have a choice. They think they're free. I mean, I'm looking at the four freedoms right now, right there. You know what? Americans aren't as free as what they would. You can't even have a fundamental choice. In New York City, you have a choice on how you're going to get your butt from point A to point B. But trust me, in the rest of the world, you don't. Or the rest of the United States, you don't. It's a car, you know? And if you could demonstrate not only the efficacy of walkable communities, new urbanism, whatever you want to call it, but also the integration of food, water, energy, built environment, advanced manufacturing, integrate those into a functioning system, all of a sudden Americans, when they start having jobs, they're not going to worry about sustainability. I mean, I live in Beaufort, South Carolina. I can't use the word sustainability because Agenda 21 and, you know, global conspiracy. You know, so I always say, well, I just replace sustainability with kumquat because kumquat's a really cute word, you know. I mean, because everyone laughs at kumquats. So nobody's going to care about kumquats if they're all of a sudden they're living in a community that is connected, that they're having their own Rosetto effect in their own hometowns. And in their own sections of a city. It works. It's way human beings have existed since we started coming together, right? And it's only since the Industrial Revolution we lost sight of that. So a new language. And guess what? Just so it's not just fluff, we can start incentivizing. Instead of drive till you qualify, we can start doing location-efficient mortgages. There's all sorts of mechanisms to make it happen on Main Street USA today. We just have to have the moral courage to do it. And the third thing is, in terms of foreign policy, because I knew you had it, Marina, got to go there. You know, we have framed things out. We were talking about this earlier. Is it hard power? Is it soft power? Is it smart power? Well, get off the power thing. What we need about to start talking about it in an interdependent system is, where do our interests converge? Converging interests is the calculus for 21st century foreign policy. Right? Not conflicting interests. When you talk in terms of power, you're talking conflicting interests. But if you start talking about converging interests, all of a sudden there's a new approach to China. There's a new approach to Iran. A lot of it has to do with taking a humanist approach in terms of, where do you get your energy? Where do you get your food? China, you got a fundamental big decision. Are you going to use your water to get coal, or are you going to use it to feed your people? That's a tough decision. And guess what? We have that same problem here in the United States. It's a burgeoning storm. China's a little bit farther out in front of us on that one, but we're following trace. That is a place where we can engage in a converging interest model and create real results. Real solution, well, approaches, because there's always going to be another problem, right? But there's new approaches, and it fundamentally redesigns how we approach foreign policy. So those are my three.
Great. I want to go ahead and open it up to questions. I want to ask people, there is a microphone in the back, so wait for the microphone. Please identify yourself, and please make sure your question is actually a question and not a you know, Castro-esque lecture. And I have someone here right in the aisle. If you could stand up, because I can't see you.
Please, where does population control...
Just pull it closer and identify yourself, please.
Evelyn Ledfors, where does population control fit into that new world order?
That is laden with great language. population control... doesn't explicitly fit into the grand strategy, is the simple way of answering that question. Addressing the challenge of rapid economic inclusion, bringing 3 billion people into the global middle class, is the challenge that we're focused on. How do you create the economic space for the 3 billion we know are coming in the next 20 years? And how do we create the space for them to thrive, for them, and for as they enter that economic, that global economy, to not crash that economy, crash our ecosystem at the same time. Because right now, we're 4% of the population consuming 25% of the resources. Where's the space for them to come in? We're focused on that. That's where we're focused on. And if there's fundamentally the challenge that is the flip side of population is creating the resources, creating the economic space for them to come in, that requires at least a tenfold increase in energy and resource intensity per unit of GDP. If we can do that, and we can create the a network of redundant, resilient, regional, continental scale economic engines in which the 4 billion people who are currently outside the reach of policy, outside the formal sector of the economy, can come in. They're going to those people coming into the formal sector in a sustainable way are going to have access to the education, to the healthcare, to the opportunities for income convergence that will allow them to make the right choices. So that's not something that we can legislate in this grant strategy. There's a lot of things that are not on strategy, as we like to call it. There's Israel-Palestine is not on strategy. We're not going to be talking about how do you pivot the global population trends. But fundamentally, we know what's cooked into the next 20 years is 3 billion people who want to come in. And if they don't come in, there's going to be a fight or many fights. And so that's what we're trying to address.
Great. And again, if you can say who you are, and I'd like to keep the questions and answers fairly short so we can get a few.
Bill Armbrust, a retired journalist. This question is for Puck Mickleby. What kind of response, if any, did you receive, not just in the military, but more importantly in the White House and Congress? And also, what hope do you have that people are going to act on it? I would love to see congressional hearings on your proposal.
Yeah. Well, we wrote the narrative specifically my time in the Pentagon in August 2009. Didn't get released to the public domain until April 2011, after Jane Harman retired from Congress and went over to Woodrow Wilson Center for Scholars. Response-wise, we never were allowed. This is an important point. I'm going to say it. We weren't allowed to go over to Congress. Because at that time, if you remember, there were certain incidents where, from 2009 through 2011. There were points where it looked like the military was getting in front of our civilian leadership. And my sense was Admiral Mullen was very concerned about that from the very fiber of this republic, that we don't do that. And a lot of the stuff that Wayne and I wrote, put in the narrative, obviously we didn't get prescriptive because we couldn't, because a lot of it had to do with domestic policy, and that's just, that's offsides from the military. And so those were those sensitivities. I will say this, though, putting the ideas out in about, from whether you're a liberal side of the fence or you're the conservative side of the fence, it's been positively received. I think it's just been positively received, these ideas. You might have to change the language a wee bit. I mean, you have to have your own little Wittgenstein moment and kick away your ladder just to convey the ideas, but it was positive. In D.C. itself, not so. I mean, it's because nobody really reads anything to try to act on anything. They just provide their battle lines. I mean, it's just the way it is. But it was weird having the concept of sustainability coming out of the Pentagon, because we are politically agnostic. I mean, we're by oath and by conviction. We're not allowed to. You know, as professional officers. And so that was difficult. But it was just another flash in the pan in D.C. The real work is in the so what stuff that we're doing now, and trying to make it real. And you had one other part. Oh, the issue of...
Are you optimistic?
I'm always optimistic. I'm one of those guys, you know, glasses bubbling over. So, you know, what else you can cry in your soup. But, I mean, I'm very optimistic. But I've said this before, and I'll say it again because I love the story. When I was a young pup, I was 18, went to airborne school, paratrooper school. And I literally like my fourth or fifth time ever getting on an airplane was to climb on. I was going to jump out of the damn thing, you know. And the sergeant airborne looked at me, because I guess I looked scared. He said, kid, if you jump out of that plane and you look up and you don't have a big, beautiful chute over your head, then don't worry about it. You got the rest of your life to figure it out. So, I mean, that's kind of where we are. That's where we are right now. We got the rest of our life. But the ground, man, that ground's coming up fast. But I'm optimistic because we don't have any other choice. You got to be optimistic. Well, hell, that's just a challenge, you know. I mean, so what? You know, there's other ways around it. You know, that's part of our implementation design is, okay, if D.C.'s busted, well, then don't go to D.C. So we're not.
Great. I want to get a couple more over there in the back, and then afterwards up here in the front, and then over there.
Thank you. My name is Ben. I'm a student at Hunter College. I have two questions. What is the trajectory of our country's reliance on non-renewable resources and renewable resources? My second question is, how does student loan debt, college affordability, and students' buying power tie into the grant strategy. Thank you.
I'll just take a quick, just to answer the last part first, at least from the perspective, again, when I was working for Admiral Mullen, our number one strategic imperative was education. Whatever it takes to build the human capital for the future, those investments in education and healthcare specifically, those are what we have to do. Because to put those on hold, well, guess what? You know, that you got one foot in a grave. So the issue of student debt, I mean, that's just, that is something of a national import that we just have to take on, you know? And I can think of lots of places where we can save money. And I guess I'll go on record now because I'm not in uniform anymore. I was a fighter pilot. That F-35 Joint Strike Fighter, what a piece of crap. That's the last thing the Marine Corps needs, all right? Last thing the Marine Corps needs, all right? Maybe somebody else needs it. We'll go sell it to them, but that's the last thing the Marine Corps needs, okay? I can fund probably a lot of educations with that money, all right? And trust me, I'm no peacenik. I mean, I was a Marine. I'm strong on defense, but come on, we got to have a little common sense in the equation too. Okay.
I think in the sustainability front, we cut off all our research on batteries, energy, and the rest in 1980, when we got rid of the engineer president, and it hasn't come back until about the last 5 to 10 years. It's absolutely critical that the research goes forward, which means we've got to have people like you, best and bright people, developing this, and we need to be supporting that. Every one of us would have a battery in our house that could collect solar energy from our roof if we had, for the last 30 years, been developing that research, and we just turned it all off.
Great. Up here.
I'm Harry Fogarty. I'm a psychoanalyst, a lecturer in psychiatry and religion. For Colonel Nickleby and Dr. Jackson, and I'm not quite sure how you would connect with this, but at the end of Beowulf...
I'm Irish, so yeah, I don't need that.
At the end of Beowulf, there's this startling line, and the monsters came back. So the heroism was great, but the monsters came back. Mm-hmm. Listening to what you said, you have formed a grand narrative. A narrative like Beowulf implies that we're listening. That what you're saying, somebody is hearing. So really I'm asking, what is it that the three of you think is going to generate or facilitate the hearer? I heard Dick refer to a tax on waste. I heard you, Colonel Nickleby, referring to a location-efficient mortgage approach. So I'm wondering, what are the strategies you imagine can help us to hear what you're saying that is obviously correct?
I've spent 40 years doing public health, I've dreamed up endless schemes and strategies to track birth defects, to prevent toxic exposures to children, on and on and on. I've never once proposed one that people said, gee, that's a good idea, let's do it. And eventually, every single time, a crisis occurred, and the boss turned and said, all right, what are we going to do? Does anybody have a good plan to deal with X? And all of a sudden, this plan that you've been working so hard on happens. That seems crazy, but I'm sure that after Superstorm Sandy, a lot of people turned around and said, oh, wow, we really need to have a good plan. And all the things that Bill Selecki and wonderful people here have been thinking about had to go forward. I can't resist saying the sidebar, which is, I found the New York Times Magazine story of the subway workers and how hard they worked in those 4 or 5 days before the storm hit absolutely admirable. And we tell so many nasty stories to people about people being ineffective, lazy, stealing. And these people are putting, just killing themselves to protect this city. And we need to, that is a narrative we need to be telling our kids as well. At least my part.
I got to hit the Beowulf part. So at the end, you had monsters come. This is why this is, Beowulf was beautifully made just for our Constitution, because, Hubert Humphrey. When he talks about the preamble of the Constitution, he points out that those words in that preamble are action words, in order to establish, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and to secure the blessing of liberty to ourselves and our posterity. He said those are action words that require constant tending, constant vigilance. Just like sustainability is a grand strategic imperative for this country, it's going to require constant tending, constant vigilance, because those monsters will come back. So, to answer in a more pragmatic way what you're talking about, what Patrick outlined, there's three big things that can fuel this economy. One is smart growth, walkable communities, housing. 56% of Americans seek the attributes of smart growth, yet only 2% of new housing startups will map to that demand. Huge, huge market opportunity right there. Second one, regenerative agriculture. I mean, according to the OECD global food supply, we have to increase global food supply by 60% by 2050, and 100% of that has to be regenerative in nature because we've exceeded ecosystem boundaries. Well, guess what? That's a big market play. You know, by the way, regenerative agriculture is just not for, you know, hippies anymore. You can actually acre per acre when you include externalities. Regenerative agriculture is 3 times more profitable than our current ag model. We can do that in the United States, make that shift to a whole new ag system to feed the world in a healthy way that actually provides stewardship for our soils and our water. And the third thing is a productivity revolution that Patrick referenced, fundamentally reducing our resource intensity per unit of GDP. We've got the technology to do it, advanced manufacturing, advanced materials, you know, 3D printing, stereolithography, but also renewable energy. It's a technology, the technologies and materials that are going to be required to deliver that middle-class lifestyle, those 3 billion people that are coming in, it's a market forces. We could do those things if we could get our brains around industrial policy and not get all amped up about it. We've always done industrial policy.
I have to tell a quick story. So I did
this video
series.
Anyway, that's what I would say. Those are three
big things we could
do. I
visited 15 locations. We visited this 640-acre subdivision in upper Illinois. They had taken about 100 acres and put a lot of housing clustered together with front porches and a real community. And the rest of it was organic farms because you can't have production agriculture right next to where people live with all the chemicals. Turned out that cornfields were generating $20 to $30 per acre before they put it in. The organic farms, when they were put in, particularly if they were direct to consumer marketing, were generating between $10,000 to $15,000 per acre and were actually an emotional heart to this community in ways that people never dreamed. And I know this sounds utopian and the monsters will always return, but we've got to fight the good fight. And in medicine, all of our patients eventually die, but you do the best you can until that happens.
Well, to summarize that theory of change, there's these two dynamics that have been woven through this conversation. It's crisis and opportunity. And really, it's a foot race between a series of crises that we know are cooked into the system because of its fundamental unsustainability, and then the need for opportunity. And one of the great places, especially being here in New York City, around opportunity is the need for reasonable returns over the long term. Institutional investors are looking for a type of return that is extraordinarily rare these days. That has to return over a 20, 30 year time horizon. We just saw, I think it was $3 trillion worth of collected assets under management with 70 firms just announced that, hey, we're really worried about climate risk in the markets, and we'd really like you oil majors to start announcing what that risk is. These two, the need for economic opportunity and the confluence with these three extraordinary pools of demand that Puck just laid out, combined with these known series of shocks and disruptive events that are coming at us, are going to create that opportunity. We were able to brief the National Security Council last year because of Hurricane Sandy. You know, it does create opportunities. The trick is surfing both and bringing those two things together, while at the same time demonstrating, because we are a deliberative, garrulous, but semi-working democracy, making sure that Americans understand what this is and are part of it and are building it from the ground up. And so it's managing those three trends. I think that's fundamental to our theory of change.
I just want to say, I know that we're out of time, but I just want to say that bottom-up thing, we are doing this. We are doing it. I'll be happy to tell you about it afterwards in some very distinct places around the country.
Okay. I think we've got time for one more in the back. You'd had your hand up for a while.
Hi, my name is Sheree Lewis-Gruss. I'm the GIS manager for the Regional Plan Association. We're an urban planning nonprofit that focuses on 31 counties in the tri-state region, New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut. So my question is for Dr. Jackson, who we're meeting with tomorrow, I believe, at a lunch. I won't be there personally, so that's why I want to get into this question now. We're developing our fourth regional plan, which comes out every 20 years or so, and my coworker Lucretia and I are in, tasked with focusing on public health indicators. So my question for you would be to basically repeat the same question that was asked before, but scale it down to our region. If there were three public health trends that you either could reverse or enhance for our region, what would they be?
One is, I think New York has done really a spectacular job. In the year 2000, the average New Yorker lived 2 to 3 years longer than the rest of the country. I'm talking older adult. It's now closer to 8 years. I think you've made marvelous progress with tobacco control, with other such issues. I think New York needs to put in place a penny a teaspoon tax on fructose. People don't need it. It's bad for your liver, and that money could be used for kids. Number two, I actually would say focus on children. Shelf life of human beings is short, and if any tax money comes in from this, or whatever fee you want to call it, kids need to walk and bike safely to school. Kids need to have learn how food is produced. One of the sweetest programs is where the grandparents go in to the schools and teach the kids how to grow food, how to prepare food. A lot of times the parents are so stressed and overworked they don't know how to do it. And three, and I don't need to tell the regional plan, transit works. And the built environment, this is what I teach in class, the built environment is social policy in concrete. If you create a built environment that is intended to meet the needs of cars and it doesn't put human beings first, it will never work. And what's worse is it won't work for 100 years. And you have to create built environments. So I teach at Berkeley in the past. They took down the Embarcadero freeway. Nobody in there would ever want to go to the Embarcadero in San Francisco. It was dirty, it was nasty, it wasn't a place anybody wanted to be. And now it's the biggest tourist attraction in town. And you walk along there, people are walking, eating healthy food, and smiling. And after all is said and done, that's what life ought to be about.
Hey, just a very, very quick last 30-second from both of you, and then I think we had some closing remarks.
The last idea I want to get out, because it's a public health audience, is that one of the other extraordinarily powerful opportunities in addressing the built environment and building walkable communities is you're also creating a new platform, ideally, for primary care delivery. And it's the focus of what Dick and some of our other colleagues, Vika Sainis, who's in the back, president of the Lounge Foundation, are focusing on, is what other multipliers do we get out of not only addressing our communities and our food system, but the fact that you're creating new spaces. Can we make this health system function more effectively? And some of the most exciting stats that we're seeing is that you get in the high utilization cohort in Medicare, you get by providing a better type of primary care, you get 40% reduction in hospitalizations. Isn't that amazing? So if we can do that, there's incredible. Where I want to end up here is that if you've got a systemic problem, you've got to address the system. You can't just come in through your issue area only. We're going to have to address all these systemic problems together. But if we do, the opportunities are amazing. So thank you very much for having us.
Last thing. Oh, I got nothing very great to say. I just want to mention that Dick said used the word utopia, and almost kind of apologetic. Well, I'm telling you, don't stink and apologize for being utopian. Because you break down the word utopia, you know I was going to say this. Utopia, there's two ways you can spell it in Greek. Topos, place, in Greek. Well, there's an outopos and there's an eutopos. Well, outopos is no place. Eutopos is good place. It's our choice as citizens of this republic. So let's get off our asses and make this a good place. Let's go for the EU and not the OU. Thank you, Pratt.